and I'm very proud to be chair of this panel, which I should say is has come forth from an idea of Linnet Taylor, who is sitting there with the wonderful red scarf. And Linnet is a professor at Tilt, the Tilt Research Group at Tilburg University. And then we have, to her left, we have Matthew Hanna, who is, as far as I understand, is a professor of cultural geography at Bayreuth University. Yes. Then on Linnet's right, we have Malavika Jayaram, who is executive director of the Digital Asia Hub in Hong Kong and is also fellow at Berkman Center for Internet and Society. Then we have David Murakami Wood, who is sitting over there, who you, the people who were already there the first session already know. And David is Canada Research Chair of Surveillance Studies and we're very happy he's here. And then finally, we have Arne Hintz, who is senior lecturer at the Data Justice Lab at Cardiff School of Journalism, and he will be moderating this session today. So I give the floor to Arne.
Yes, so on the program, you've probably seen that Stefania Milan was supposed to be the moderator. I'm not Stefania, hello. I'm Arne, but I'm very thankful to Stefania that she dropped out and that she couldn't come today. She will be here the other days because it's a really interesting session, I think, a very interesting speakers at Cardiff. We're at the moment, we're in the process of setting up something that we call the Data Justice Lab, where we're very interested in working on these very issues that are discussed here today in this session. And I think we want to zoom in here really on some of the key questions of datafication. Datafication has been one of the big debates recently, and mostly recently, I guess, in academia. We've heard a lot about how data allows us to, or not so much us, but generally governments and businesses to sort and categorize people, essentially in a way as good and bad citizens. Already in some of the sessions today, we've heard about the Chinese plans for the social credit scores and so on and so on. Developments which are happening elsewhere too, and data has become, and datafication has become in some way instruments of power and discipline. And this leads to some relevant questions. Who benefits and how does power shift in datafied societies? How can this power shift be contested? And how is data collection and data processing resisted? And then particularly with an interest for this panel, what are historical trajectories of the datafied management of people and how it is resistant and how it is contested from 19th century social physics to the censuses and their resistance in the 20th century to datafied sorting and categorizing now in the 21st century. And what can we learn from all this for the challenges that we're facing today and the things that are happening today? And so what we want to do here, I think, is go beyond a kind of a narrow techno-legal focus on datafication and look at some of the underlying dynamics of datafied governance and the resistance, possible resistance paths against it and how people interact and negotiate these. And so, yes, we have a panel to address these dynamics, and we'll go in some way in a chronological order. We start by David to take us off into ancient times of data-based management and the collection of data and information. And then Matthew Hanna will fast forward us to the 1980s and with the resistance against the censuses. Then, and Linnet Taylor and Malavika Jayaram will look at these insights then more in connection with current developments in different parts of the world. So let's start with David and the historical perspective.
Right. Okay, I have no PowerPoint. I'm actually having a bit of an anti-PowerPoint phase at the moment. I think we use it too much, so I'm going to just talk, and hopefully you can listen. I'm actually a geographer. I'm an undercover geographer because I'm in a sociology department where I pretend to be a sociologist. And as a geographer, I tend to notice the kind of spatial aspects of things that generally people think of as only social, whatever that means. So when we talk about personal data, we often discount immediately or don't talk about the spatial elements of this. And what I want to talk about here is the fact that data, personal data and personal data gathering has long been intimately connected with systems of spatial sorting and spatial analysis. Geographers tend to talk of the current turn as what they call the kind of combination of information, searchable databases, and geographic information systems as the geospatial web or geoweb. When I first heard this term, I was thinking, wait, what on earth is this? And it turned out to be exactly the same thing as surveillance studies scholars talk about when they talk about these issues. So there's a, but the geographers have this really, I think, useful way of reminding us that all of the time, this is always spatial. Let's go back to the 19th century. The conventional histories of personal data collection, especially since Josh Lauer's really excellent work, remind us that this really begins with the Commercial Credit Reporting Bureau, which started operations in US cities in the mid-19th century. The Mercantile Company, which became Dun & Bradstreet, was formed in 1841. And Dun & Bradstreet, by the way, still remains a massive business analytics company with a market capitalization of around $4 billion. So this company that started in 1841 on consumer credit reporting still operates and still does much the same sort of thing. These credit reporting bureau were almost immediately accessible to state and private detective agencies, from Pinkertons, the famous private detectives, to later to the FBI, and who used them to identify suspects, as well as the stores using them to identify who was credit worthy. These credit reporting techniques expanded rapidly, and in the early 20th century gave birth to a new commercial discipline of market research, typified most commonly by the A.C. Nielsen Company, which began by conducting household surveys of grocery purchases, but then with the penetration of radio and later television into American households, expanded almost immediately into the analysis of listening and viewing habits, and combining those things together so they could see in both ways how advertising was targeted and how it was feeding back in terms of viewing habits. There was almost immediately that cycle of looking both ways at how people's habits were going about. However, there's also another route into this kind of world, and it's not through that sort of commercial credit scoring work, but through the kind of philanthropic and welfareist utilitarian research done in 19th century London and Paris by various public-minded bourgeois citizens. And a good example of this is Charles Booth, who in his 17-volume Atlas of Poverty in London differentiated different particular areas of the city based on their characteristics. So he characterized poorer areas with the color black as vicious and semi-criminal, right up to the gold, wealthy populations. And these classification systems were adapted as well into market research. So when you see the market research companies operating in the early 20th century, they combine the credit bureau's type of personal information scoring with always a spatial aspect, which starts to categorize people by where they live and where they cluster together as much as who they are and what they do. So if you look at the ABCD system, the classic system invented by the J. Walter Thompson Corporation, according to Paul Cherington, who was one of the leading researchers with this organization, category D, for example, here, identified on maps, was the homes of unskilled laborers or in foreign districts where it is difficult for American ways to penetrate. It's very similar to Charles Booth's kind of analysis of the vicious semi-criminal populations, and also reminds us a lot of Donald Trump's assertions recently on what are the great threats to making America great again. This, of course, leads directly into, and I won't go into this too much today, the racist classificatory schema that could be found in forms of racial segregations and redlining of black neighborhoods by real estate banks and other financial services that operated, of course, in the US, but also less overtly in other countries in the world. And there was some mention of this morning I briefly heard in a previous session, which I didn't have the chance to hear the whole talk of, but we've seen some more of this already today. Of course, although officially redlining is outlawed now, it continues in the form of discriminatory practices of lending, a lot of which gave rise to the subprime crisis that set the whole world financial system, that destroyed the whole world financial system temporarily in 2008. Now, of course, these, just to carry on with this story for a little bit, these kinds of basic forms of market research and spatial analysis were really, really combined most effectively from the 1960s onwards, which is when essentially the various forms of geographic information system came into being. So-called geodemographics was pioneered by the General Analytics Company, which developed a form of what's called multivariate cluster analysis to replace the ABCD type of classification systems. What it did was convert official US government census data into more commercially usable forms based on the well-understood postal zip codes in the US, which are postal codes for those of you don't live in America. Subsequently, the company changed its name to Claritas, which is the name it's still well known under today, and adopted its digital system to the digitally encoded data that the US Census began to develop from the late 1960s. So essentially, the state deployment of digitally encoded census forms allowed private corporations then to build a new business model based on spatially classifying populations in order to sell to them. These cluster analysis models were further modernized with the advent of the geographic information system proper, as was the US Census Bureau finally from 1990, with what was called the Topographic Integrated Geographic Encoding and Referencing System, TIGER. I mean, the acronym is basically driving the term there rather than the other way around. So since then, we've seen multiple specialist spatial data companies emerging, which combine census-based geodemographic data with other data on individuals from other sources, including market surveys, credit loyalty card records, court records, and almost now, as we see in the era of big data, an infinite variety of personal data. So now, if you look at the descendants of this system, just to finish up, Claritas's current system, known as PRIZM, P-R-I-Z-M, has 66 segments which classify the population both socially and spatially, including factors like life stage and urbanicity. You can see a simple version of this online as My Best Segments, and you can go and look and play around with it and see how you fit into this thing. It ranges from number one, upper crust, through things like new homesteaders, down to the bottom category, big city blues. And the racial characteristics of these segments are still highly visible. So that hasn't changed very much, despite the fact we have had in between, in the USA at least, a civil rights movement which has supposedly got rid of spatial segregation in any formal sense. Not coincidentally, Claritas is now part of the AC Nielsen group. AC Nielsen has become one of the most enormous and probably most influential organizations in the world in terms of marketing. It was actually briefly owned by Dun & Bradstreet, who we came to at the beginning, but then Dun & Bradstreet sold it off again and expanded using private equity. It isn't publicly marketed, so we don't know exactly how big it is, but according to the official rankings from the American Marketing Association, AC Nielsen is now the world's largest market research company on the basis of this kind of segmentation analysis. Of course, where we are now, just to finish off, is that this kind of fixed-in-place spatial analysis is increasingly supplemented or replaced by mobile forms of analysis. The idea, or should I say ideal, of m-commerce, that is marketing to people on the move, has become, since the 1990s, the latest obsession of marketers. Never mind the fact that it doesn't work in any way whatsoever, as Kirsty Ball and I have shown in previous research, this is still where lots of money is being put into research in this area. So we now see various forms of mobile marketing added to this sort of spatial segregation. Of course, the other major development, just to finish off, which other speakers will probably talk about later, is that increasingly consumers are not just being mined for their data, they're also generating it voluntarily through their own activities, and also other aspects of their activities, not just purchases and so on, are being sought for this data, but also even feelings. So what's called affective marketing is now coming into play, where people's kind of sensibilities, feelings, and ideas are being added into the mix. So we've got a layer of like of extra penetration into the soul or the brain and of the person, as well as the mobility of the people beyond their spatially fixed categories as they previously were. It's no accident then that AC Nielsen has started to buy up neuro research companies, as has Google, of course, by the way. And it's not just for artificial intelligence purposes that people tend to assume. Companies are very interested in neuro research, neurological research, to see how they can actually pre-influence people and make them more susceptible to marketing messages, as well as discovering, you know, their thoughts and feelings in a more intimate way. So there's a very, very brief skate through the history of marketing research from the 19th century to the present day. I hope that we all see a kind of some more detailed, you know, in sort of stuff coming from different people on the rest of the panel. Thank you. I do have a paper, by the way, if anybody's interested in having that later to see the more you know, intimate history of those things.
I'll go around this way.
Yeah, so we've heard about several ways of classifying and sorting people, specifically by business sector. Now we're looking at one particular instance of resistance against forms of classification, particularly in forms of state-based classification.
Right. Hello. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Linnet, for Linnet or Linnet?
Linnet.
Linnet, sorry, for the invitation. I'm a Southern American, so yeah. I want to say Linnet. What I'm going to talk about briefly today is all based on research that's been published in this book by me, if you're interested, Dark Territory in the Information Age, with a very nice endorsement from David on the back cover. So we're part of a citation cartel. The book tells a very complicated story about two rounds of census, anti-census boycott movements in West Germany in the 1980s. There was a grassroots movement that started in late 1982, focused on the census scheduled for the spring of 1983. No one expected it. It developed quickly, but to even more surprising for everyone involved, the German Constitutional Court actually halted the census in April of 1983. In order to examine more carefully all of these issues that are actually the center of this conference. And in December of 1983, they came back and declared parts of the census law unconstitutional. And in doing so, sort of sketched what they called a right of informational self-determination. And this right is now one of the centerpieces in principle of European data protection law, not just German data protection law. There were then a lot of negotiations, but in 1987, finally, a census was once again on the table. This census was, am I audible to the people recording this? Okay. This census was actually taken. Because it was taken, the protests were larger. It went on for a much longer period, ended up involving people being hounded by security forces years after the census because of their refusal ever to give information to the government. Very interesting story. What I want to do today is just briefly talk about strategies of resistance that were either recommended by the... Strategies of resistance that were either recommended by the 1983 movement, but then never realized because the census was never taken, or that were actually carried out in the 1987 movement. The book itself was motivated by an interest in what I call epistemic sovereignty, a sort of implicit claim by a state to be able to know everything that goes on within its territory. And coming from a kind of background of Foucault, I was curious about whether this term was an interesting hinge between biopolitics and sovereignty. But I'll leave all that aside and just talk, as I said, about these... Okay, good, thank you. Yeah. I know I have a loud voice, so I thought this was all going okay. Okay. Is this better? Yeah, okay, I can hear that it's better. So I thought I'd just single out a few of these resistance strategies from the 1980s, because I think from our perspective now, 30 years later, it might be interesting to see how plausible they would be or what has happened to some of them, either in being updated or in some cases actually turned around into ways of collecting data. The first general strategy, which came out right at the very beginning of the 1983 census boycott movement, was the notion of a sort of transparency quid pro quo. At that time in West Germany, there was a very strong peace and anti-war movement centered on the stationing of Pershing missiles on West German soil. And the earliest boycott initiatives proposed that citizens give their personal information on the census in exchange for information about where Pershing missiles would be stationed. This was quickly dropped by the boycott movements as too specific an interest. But I think it raises this interesting issue now of the way transparency has been put forward as a solution, or at least partial solution, to some data protection issues. And I think one of the problems we would see more clearly today is a strong mismatch between the transparency of citizens to very large organizations with increasingly automated infrastructures, who in effect have no limits to the amount of attention they can pay to us. And on the other hand, the transparency in principle of these large organizations and algorithms and such, which is a very nice thing, but it's not a transparency that embodied human beings are can easily take advantage of, even if it's available. So that's one of the issues I find interesting out of a current perspective. A second strategy, which was also already suggested in 1983, was that people simply not accept forms handed out to them by enumerators or placed in their mailboxes. And this led to an interesting set of legal battles over the question of whether the existence of a piece of mail in your mailbox legally constitutes your having received it. And of course, nowadays, this whole question has been transferred into the format of digital information. But it's still an interesting question. And it's certainly a question that motivates marketing strategies aimed at email, or the new fact that videos start up automatically as you scroll through them on Facebook, for example. These are all sort of, in my view anyway, sort of updates of this same problem. How are we confronted with data in a way that makes it harder and harder for us to not accept it, so to speak? Third marketing strategy. Resistance strategy. I'll show you on the version of the talk I didn't give, for reasons similar to David's reasons. I was just going to show some slides, but then I thought, I'm not really here to entertain you so much as to try to say something with real substance. Okay, hold on a second. How do I do this? I'm also a Mac person, so from current slide, here we go. Great. There was a cabaret group called the Three Tornadoes in Berlin, West Berlin at the time, who proposed swamping the federal government with lots of data in many different formats. So here was their little letter to the editor of Die Tageszeitung, the alternative national newspaper, and a couple quotes taken out of this letter. They start out, there's something in the papers every day about Prince Charles and Lady Di. And the basic message is, finally they ask us things, and they just ask these stupid questions about Quadratmeter, square meters of living space and so on. But we have more to say. Then they go into this long litany in the middle of the letter about the individual people in there, living collective and all the personal problems that are going on. So at the end they say, we urge you, do the same. We didn't learn to read and write only to make crosses and pencil marks. And add a couple of vacation photos or pictures from that dinner in April 1980 at the Greek place. But of course, nowadays, when we look at this as a resistance strategy, it was very plausible at the time, but nowadays what we see there is Facebook. And this gets back to David's point that this trend of people freely making information about themselves available. So viewed from the present, looking backward, this resistance strategy would be a much more difficult one to realize, given the massively expanded processing power and other technical aspects of surveillance systems. The final of the four strategies I think is interesting to think about was realized to an interesting extent in 1987, when the boycott did happen, and it was known as the hard boycott. And the basic idea here was that every household or citizen should clip off the barcode on their census form and give the blank form back to designated collection points, who would then total up the number of forms they'd received and add that to a national aggregate. The Green Party was very instrumental in supporting this, and they did actually collect over 1 million blank forms. And the basic idea here was, we will decide how to count ourselves in a truly anonymous census. There was, of course, a counter argument at the time, and the counter argument was, the longer the census goes on, the clearer it'll be what are the blank spaces left in each neighborhood map, so to speak. And so even though we might not be able to trace a particular clipped form back to your household, we will know that your household did not answer the census. So this was taken up by many activists as the idea of a resistance map, sort of saying dialectically, the better the boycott is in getting people not to send in forms, the better defined the resistance map of troublemakers in West Germany will be. And nowadays, it's an interesting thing to think about. But I think one of the interesting overall issues about a census is that it offers a very good opportunity for people to take being counted as a political matter. Because unlike most forms of data gathering nowadays, it's something that depends on individuals actually participating all over a territory. And for that reason, it's something that both states and private data gatherers try to avoid as much as possible in the various ways that we're familiar with today. Okay, I wanted to say a couple more things about the different contexts today. Let me see if any of these are really worth taking my last 20 seconds for. Nah, not really. Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Is that close enough to the microphone? Can you hear me? In the back? Okay.
The technician, rather.
I'm short enough that I think this works okay. So my purpose is only to entertain, fortunately, so I do have slides. I will also be dancing later. So my interest in this topic came out of a book published by Sandy Pentland, a professor at MIT in the Media Lab, back in 2014, titled Social Physics, Lessons from a New Science. And as someone who was engaging with the field of critical data studies at the time, I started thinking, hang on, this, I'm not close enough. Okay. See, this will help when I start singing. This is much more appropriate. The idea that social physics was a new science clearly was incorrect. He actually acknowledges that in the introduction and gives a brief history of social physics stretching back to the 1840s. So it was interesting to me why he would make that claim in the title and assume that people wouldn't be interested enough to read the introduction. So I started looking at how people have perceived social physics over the centuries and what resistance to it has been. David and Matt gave a much more clear history of social physics than I will, but we can see the first quantitative studies of behavior emerging around the time that sort of statistics are emerging, obviously, too, in the sort of early 1800s. By Comte and Saint-Simon, coming out of Enlightenment thinking about the way that we can study society, the way that maybe things obey laws. The idea is that obviously you're searching for universal laws governing human behavior, which is why today we find a lot of theoretical physicists involved in social physics. Eventually, we see in our age with big data, which is what I'm interested in here, something where power sort of becomes inscribed in data through a form of methodological or claims to methodological dominance. This was as true in the invention of statistics as it is today, I think. Chris Anderson's claim that big data is the end of theory, whether ironic or not, is very pertinent here. He's claiming that a new methodology will transform the way that we use data, the way that we think about data, and also the way that we think about society and the study of society. Big data is widely claimed to be new, ahistorical, and revolutionary in various ways. I'm sorry?
The slide show with F5.
Oh, sorry. I didn't realize it wasn't.
It's
Sorry. There, is that better? Sorry. Okay. I think one thing that we can trace is a shift from legibility to visibility. And anyone who's read the stuff I've reading, sorry, who's read the stuff I've been writing, this came out a couple of years ago, but the idea is that we become legible to the state through classic survey methods of the kind being discussed by Matthew just now, which aim to sort of situate populations in particular areas to produce geodemographic information, to sort and categorize with the end of making people governable by the state. And Scott has done a very good job of explaining that in his book, Seeing Like a State. But later on, we move into the era of big data, and we arrive at visibility through informational capitalism and through commercial modes of data collection and data gathering, which I would argue lead to distributed governance of population data. So as David was correctly pointing out, we get geodemographic data collected by the state being married to commercial data, being married to behavioral data, being married to even predictive data about feelings gathered from, you know, sentiment analysis and social media material. And we get a visibility that is very different from state legibility. One thing I would, and Shimmer has very correctly said, big data are not about society, they're about users and markets. We only see where people are using particular technologies which cost money, which are produced in certain ways, and which have a particular infrastructural geography. So they show us some of society, they do not show us all of society. What happens when we marry these data sources to conventional survey methodologies and survey data? And I would argue that what happens is that we lose representation to some extent, that legibility doesn't have to, but it has the option to include a measure of mutuality, of reciprocity between citizen and government, between citizen and data collector, where you're giving up your data to a census taker, as your presentation shows very clearly, you also have the potential to argue, to negotiate, and to resist. With visibility, performed through big data and through merging and linking of commercial versus public sector data sets, we start to lose that potential for reciprocity. Dewey has something to say about this. He says that the role of the body politic as a whole is to engage with the consequences of policy groupings, that policy proceeds by grouping, categorizing, and sorting for action, and that politics is, that democratic politics should be about the whole body politic responding to that, since it's not realistic for individuals to perceive where they are being grouped, sorted, categorized for action necessarily. So we could posit here that invisible data analytic groupings of the kind characterized by big data visibilities might be weakening the possibility of democratic political action. And this is a large part of the new book on group privacy that has just come out, edited by me, Bart over there, and Luciana Floridi. So I recommend that if you're interested in the relationship of data to democracy and representation particularly. Thinking this through, we arrive at a notion of data justice, and I'll go into its roots in a moment, but I'm positing that one vision of data justice involves both positive and negative freedoms with regard to visibility and legibility, that we should have the right to constructive versions of legibility and democratic versions of legibility, and also the right to selectively resist datafied visibility, and that we need a framework that enables us to distinguish one from the other, and to choose what to resist or what to negotiate and discuss. So here I divide up the idea of data, one idea of data justice, there are several, into three parts, one of which is visibility through data, where you should have the right to be counted and represented, but also informational privacy about the other forms of data you're producing that you may not want to hand over. That you have engagement with technology where you have the freedom to participate in data generation and in its benefits, in its products, but also the freedom to determine your own use of technology. This is where it gets tricky. Finally, non-discrimination, which is being dealt with very well at Cpdp this year, the freedom to challenge bias, and also the right not to be discriminated against. So again, you have sort of a positive right and a negative right there. The first positive right element is about opting in. This has been dealt with fairly well by among others, Johnson and then Heeks and Rankin, both writing in 2016, on open data, particularly Johnson's idea of information justice and fair representation through data. And then Heeks and Rankin talk about development informatics and how we cover populations that are not so easily visible through conventional methodologies. They both have a focus on access, participation, and representation. So they're talking about reciprocity through various forms of datafied visibility. One interesting example that's recently come up is that the French High School Students Union challenged the Ministry of Education in France to explain the algorithm it uses to put people into for college placement, basically, to allocate people to universities, which is a very important form of social categorization in France, obviously. And they actually managed to get the Ministry of Education under the new loi numérique to release half the code for its algorithm. It's only released half, but then hackers came together to analyze that code and found, they think, that the college placement algorithm prioritizes students from territoire d'outre-mer, so French students from outside the main territory of France, the mainland. They're not completely sure because they only have half the code. And it's led to an interesting debate about, should all the code be released? What does it mean to be transparent in this context? You know, if you're just releasing code rather than explaining the algorithm, does that constitute transparency? Anyway, so there are ways of opting in, but also ways of opting out. This picture is of what happened to the Amsterdam Records, Public Records Office in 1943, when men from the resistance blew it up. Sorry, probably women too. This is sort of a form of census boycott, I would argue. It's designed to make sure that the occupying Nazis at that time could not get hold of the records of people they would want to destroy, basically. So this is one form of resistance and opting out, but it's fairly extreme, which leads us to the question of what kinds of opting out would be considered reasonable and helpful and constructive in an information society? What kinds of opting out are possible within a social contract that works? And under what conditions is non-cooperation seen as beneficial? I'm thinking right now in the UK, we have a lot of efforts to register migrants. Children in primary school are being asked to register where they come from, where their families come from. Students in university are being asked to register where they're originally from, whatever that means. Faculty are being asked to register their students' place of origin with a view to, in the case of Brexit happening, to kicking out the people that we want to kick out, to systematic exclusion of certain migrants rather than others. There is a case that natives who have the freedom not to answer these questions can actually exercise their right not to, in order to create exactly the kind of blank spaces in population registries that Matthew was just talking about, that if all of us refuse to register the origin of our children, then no one will be able to find the migrants, obviously. Similarly, you probably saw on social media, the mayor of New York recently preemptively refused to engage with any special registration practices by the incoming Trump administration, promising that the city itself would be a blank space in many ways. So I think we see both opportunities to opt in and opt out, but opting out is obviously much harder to do, much harder to justify, and I think we need to have a good discussion about not only how we want to be represented, but what we want the blank spaces to be. And how that discussion should take place is another important question, I think. Thank you very much.
Thank you, which brings us to the question of how to resist and how to contest and negotiate in current times. But one more speaker, Malavika, please.
Hi there. I've flown in from Hong Kong, so I'm terribly jet-lagged, so you're going to get a stream of consciousness presentation. I'm going to throw out a couple of quotes to see if you're actually awake and paying attention, and tell me what you think they refer to. So one is a slogan from a poster which says, "Who are you? We have the answer." Anyone? What do you think that might be selling, advertising?
Genetics.
Good call. Anything else? This is a thing that actually exists. The Indian biometric identity system, which I found deeply problematic, which sort of implies that if you're not in the system, well, we'll tell you who you are. You don't have an identity until we give you one, which I find problematic. The other one is it describes a system as allowing the trustworthy to roam everywhere under heaven while making it hard for the discredited to take a single step. Excellent, yep. Yeah, under the heaven thing. Yeah, exactly. So it's the new Chinese credit scoring system, the social credit, which I think a lot of people know as Sesame, which is one implementation of it by Alibaba, the biggest marketplace there. So I sort of wanted to throw out these two things as examples of where we're going with credit scoring and documentation and identification now from a completely different part of the world where you have a lot of people, all of whom are being put into databases and have been, and they're not uncontested territories. We've had, you know, a very fraught history of the caste census in India, and it was something that was last done in 1931 and never had it in post-independence India until 2011. And when it was done a very long time ago, the idea was it actually was going to cause unrest amongst the natives, because when people realized just how few people were of the higher caste, the whole country was going to revolt at how they were all being subjugated. And again, it was a similar sort of exercise in 2011 when some people protested the idea of even looking at something as retrograde as caste, but other people saying, well, it exists, and the more we can, you know, document and quantify this, the more we know whether affirmative action has actually helped and what else we need to do to fix this problem. So I just wanted to mention these two systems. And I think two of the things I'm studying are census databases in India and China, but also the idea of biometric identification systems in Asia. And they have extremely different narratives. One of the things I find interesting with the Sesame Credit one, or the social credit one in India, is when you look at the 2014 planning document that set this up, it talks about how, on one hand, it's part of a market economy system, but on the other hand, it's very integral to the idea of a sincerity culture, which to me, you know, that doesn't have any basis in law as far as I know. But it's this idea that it's not just about gauging finances, it's not just about trustworthiness financially, but about every single aspect of your life. And eventually all citizens will be required to be a part of this. But some of the quotes that, you know, I've seen from people who are actually running these systems is, well, someone who plays video games for 10 hours a day would be considered an idle person. And I'm thinking, well, that's many of my friends. And someone who frequently buys diapers would be considered as probably a parent, you think, or someone with a crazy fetish, who on balance is more likely to have a sense of responsibility. I mean, I know parents are the most irresponsible people on the planet, and, you know, non-breeders who are seriously responsible. So, you know, this is the kind of crazy sort of social sorting that they're trying to do. But it talks about, and this again is a, you know, David will see that this is a very Chinese sort of framing, which is that social credit will forge a public opinion environment that trust keeping is glorious, and warning that the new system will reward those who report acts of breach of trust. So again, it's this, you know, it's very embedded into the social fabric in a way that you get points for reporting on other people, you get points for what your friends are doing, you're discredited, and, you know, minus points for other sort of egregious behavior, which could be really minor. And the other link to the census attempt in China is, previously it's just something people did automatically, and there was a lot of, you know, public opinion that supported it. But when they did the most recent one in 2010, there was actually a lot of resistance from people who normally wouldn't protest this. And it was interesting that it turned out to be largely for two factors. One was the increased presence of immigrants, many of whom were undocumented. So for them, the idea of suddenly being recorded in a census was troubling. And the second thing was violation of the one-child policy, which again made people less willing to contribute to the census. And, you know, there were wonderful interviews with census workers who'd been doing the rounds for many years and who said they'd never had the level of abuse from people that they've had now when they go knocking from door to door. And so what they did when people were being resistant to actually contributing data was they resorted to counting beds and toothbrushes in the absence of people actually volunteering accurate data in migrant workers' dormitories and elsewhere. So these are just sort of some examples of where these two sort of systems are going. And Travis Hall, who's done a lot of really interesting work, his PhD was on different biometric systems, including the use of tattoos in Nazi Germany and the biometric system in India. And he makes this really interesting point about how, while identification leads to social sorting, it's often the drives for social sorting that lead to identification. So he points out how reflexive and circular this can be. And he talks about how in India, for example, the fact that it's democratic and socialist means that the democratic component necessitates the identification of individuals as citizens and therefore potential voters, whereas socialism requires the distinction between individuals of varying economic needs to benefit from social welfare programs. So the political structuring of the Indian state requires a very close relationship between a government and its populace. But as we've seen with the Chinese, I'm sorry, I keep sort of going back and forth between the Chinese and the Indian system, chalk it up to jet lag. But in both systems, we're seeing the huge existence of gray markets where identities are being bought and sold. So with the Chinese system, they're worried about a kind of black market when people can pay for fake online profiles. They can boost their scores, they can buy likes, they can buy social network followers. So that's sort of one kind of credit boosting that's happening. And you know, different ways of manipulating that. And in India, we've already found the data is being sold. We've also found different sort of weird acts of subterfuge and resistance. My favorite one is of the person who, when he was asked to register, he's managed to sort of trick the biometric systems, and he's registered with a picture of his phone, not his face. It's a surprise that made it through the system, but in terms of all the fields that he's filled in, he's given the name of Kothmir, which means cilantro in a lot of Indian languages, and he has his first name. His last name is biryani, which is a kind of, you know, rice dish, and his date of birth he's given sometime in the 1800s. And the system hasn't picked up any of these weird things. And so when papers started publishing saying, you know, clearly the system doesn't work, how does someone who's clearly trying to either game the system or point out how ridiculously inept it is, how does this pass through the system? A lot of other people in the neighborhood, little old men, said, well, at least he's in the system. I've been trying to register for months, and I still haven't got my ID. At least Mr. Kothmir is onto something. So, you know, there are these daily little, someone's registered with a picture of a tree. Some people have done it with dogs. Pomeranians, lots of Pomeranians in the system. And this is exactly what the biometrics was supposed to solve for you know, all the fakes and errors and duplicates in the system, the exceptions. And that hasn't really happened. But despite the fact that it doesn't work, I think a lot of people, and this is especially true of a sort of more patronizing Western debate when you see that, where this idea of something is better than nothing, or that, well, it's good enough for the developing world, it's good enough for poor people, it doesn't need to be perfect, you know, at least it's improving on what it was, or this idea that privacy is a luxury, poor people don't need it, or they've got other human rights to worry about, privacy sort of way down that chain. And it's a trade-off, it's a balance, all these sort of, you know, the usual metaphors. But I think in countries like India and China, it's always the weakest who bear the burden of proof and of resisting the system. And they're fighting a very, very strong narrative that if you're not counted, you don't count. And this is especially true of all the development efforts that sort of tag identification and documentation and inclusion in a database as being your enabler and your passport and your entry point to actually getting benefits. So just to wrap up, and sort of picking up on what Linnet was saying about legitimacy and visibility, there is a danger that a lot of these systems, in trying to include, end up excluding the marginalized, the poor, the people who most need the identification because they don't have any other documents, are the ones who are most likely to be pushed out of the system, either because they have poor quality fingerprints, because they've been worn away by manual labor, because they have cataracts or malnutrition, which don't register with iris scans. They're the ones who are least likely to be benefited. And I think there was a Forbes article which showed that of the people who've been registered, and it's a massive number of almost a billion, about 0.2% of those, or 0.02%, even, are those who previously had no documentation at all. So the ones who most needed the system aren't in it, and everybody else in the middle class and the rich people have been registered even though they didn't need it. So this, I think in terms of resistance, it's really, really hard. I find it difficult because I'm up against a tide of people saying, but it makes government transparent. It actually doesn't. It makes the citizen transparent and visible, and it keeps government as opaque as it's always been. There is also this idea that somehow the machine is neutral, that anytime you automate something or digitize it, it's automatically better and more democratic, because there is this idea that the middleman is corruptible, humans are venal, humans can be bought, you have to negotiate against them. And so in countries that are rife with corruption, anything that is replaced by a system and something sterile, automatic, you know, with matrix-like blue numbers and science fiction-looking interfaces, is automatically presumed to have less bias. So the idea of algorithmic bias, the idea of systems embedding structural inequalities, of them amplifying existing inequalities, just doesn't get as much resonance, which is why I think also when you're dealing with countries where privacy or, you know, these kinds of ethics are seen as a very individualistic concern or something that doesn't hold true in their societies, that it's some kind of, you know, weird enlightenment construct that doesn't apply to India and China, because we live our lives at the fundamental unit is the family, it's not the individual. There is this idea that collectively society could benefit from these systems and redress historic inequalities. But I think that's why the work that Linnet and others have been doing on group privacy and the idea that there are values that protect privacy, that ideas of privacy protect society as a whole and not just individuals, that it's even if it's anonymized and aggregated and it's not personal data, that the impact is visited upon individuals. So I think that's a really important point to make, especially when you're dealing with, I think, one of the most evil things that has been highlighted by sociologists in India is the idea of arbitrariness and bureaucracy as a form of state-rendered structural violence against people, and how the arbitrariness within democracy, within democracies and bureaucracies is itself a form of state-inflicted violence. So, and when you couple that with errors and false positives and false negatives and biometrics that don't quite work the way they're supposed to, I kind of think that you're moving from a panoptic sort to a panoptic sort of, and I think that's just not good enough. Thank you.
Okay, great. So we've had a number of very different and interesting perspectives on the question of identification, then leading to classification and sorting, and then the question of possibilities for resistance. We have 10 more minutes. Let's have a conversation. Any comments, any questions from the audience? I'm told I have to move a bit further here. And those of you who have a question here in the front, please, I'll give you the microphone for as long as this cable goes. And those of you in the back, just shout, and then we'll repeat it here into the microphone. Okay, so. Any comments or questions, Seda?
I want to connect the two panels. So the one before this was about smart cities and how technologies are becoming infrastructure and their kind of modes of production, and this one the focus on data. And I want to ask, if you think about what we discussed in the previous panels, in the sense that these technology companies become infrastructure, I wonder if data is the right unit through which we get resistance, because more data means the infrastructure keeps on going, right? Doesn't necessarily bring it down, or whether there are limitations that we should think about, but there's still some utility. And the reason I say that is because of the big five, so Amazon, Google, Microsoft, Apple, and Facebook. I think that they're more interested in making the cloud go and being like fundamental infrastructure than actually the quality and the classification issues that we're talking about here. So is it sufficient to only think about the classification without thinking about the production of infrastructure? Can we opt out of infrastructure? Is that something we would think about as resistance?
Okay, so just to repeat in three words, connection, the questions about the connection between the previous panel, smart cities, discussion on technology and infrastructure there, and the panel here, is data the proper unit to think about resistance, or should we
think,
and what are the limitations? Anyone? Yeah.
Oh, we're not. Thanks. I'll just lean forward. So this is a great question, because I too wonder about this a lot. I think about a lot of what we're discussing today as things becoming byproducts of informational capitalism. Like a lot of the data that the state will use about us in the future to determine our, not just our credit worthiness, but our social worthiness, is going to be produced accidentally by huge corporations trying to do completely different things. And that is really important because it means that no one is trying to put in place at the commercial end any kind of protection to stop that happening necessarily, that this sort of interface is becoming not only invisible but not worthy of recognition in some way. It's like, well, as somebody said in the previous panel, as you say, you know, the government can ask commercial sources for their data And there is a permission to pass it because no one's really looking in that direction. But what happens when there is an inevitable channel that grows between these the commercial and the public sector based on population data to be used for what seem like innocuous purposes of security, of research, of education? You know, what are the effects of all of this invisible and uncared for production of data?
Yeah, I think that's a really good response. It's a very good question. I was struck when listening to Linnet's talk about how much of the critique of big data is not restating the critique that was made of new surveillance by people like Gary Marks and David Lyon, but sort of restating it in a new format. And I think that answer's really kind of dealt with some of my concerns about that. But I also think the invisibility question relates not just to the data, but also the systems themselves. And that's what the point of infrastructure, right, is it vanishes out of the view. I've been wondering for a while, I've written about this, about to what extent our ability to see the systems that see us affect the politics of that. And some people argue it's not relevant, like it's just a kind of side issue, but I think it's really important. I think, for example, as we've seen, you know, camera systems get smaller and get less visible, people get less concerned about street surveillance. As things sort of sink into the fabric of society, it becomes very hard to engage with them. So it's not, yeah, I agree, it's not just the data, but it's every aspect from the sensors themselves through to the actual production methods through to the data itself and then through to the ways in which they're then retranslated back onto society. All of those things are becoming more invisible and more opaque. I mean, we heard earlier on from Gemma in the previous panel that many of these systems don't work, right? They collapse, they fail, they're littering the cityscape, and this is true. But one thing I really think is that, and this has been an argument in surveillance studies for quite a long time, we can't rely on failure to protect us. This is sometimes the answer, the British answer to this is always, oh, nothing works, the government's incompetent. We're safe because no one can actually make these things work. But then, you know, you get a Donald Trump coming in and you wonder, you know, the kind of answer is it could never happen here, basically, which has always been this very complacent attitude. And I think we're going to see in the next 4 years, when you get a determined populist authoritarian, or fascist, if you like, how much a kind of mass surveillance system like that's been established in the USA will suddenly become transformed to ways that we never saw being used before, and how much a Chinese system like the Sesame one will become, you know, become remarkably indistinguishable from the kind of things that Donald Trump might want to do. In fact, you know, many of the same companies are involved in a lot of the same systems as well.
Let's see if there are other comments and questions. There's one here and one there. Yes.
Thanks very much. So Angela Daly from Queensland University of Technology and the Australian Privacy Foundation. Just kind of, I don't know if you're aware of the census in Australia last year, so which actually, and I think the whole kind of controversy and, well, omnishambles around that census actually reinforces some of the arguments that were being made kind of about this sort of data gathering and I suppose population sorting in general. So the census is compulsory for all people, so citizens and non-citizens, and people can be fined if they do not actually kind of fill in the census or if they give false or misleading information as well. But this particular census kind of caused a lot more problems than normal because it was a census delivered for the first time online, or that was the preferred method of filling it in. You had to request a paper form if you didn't want to fill it in online, which itself was a problematic process. And also for the first time, the government said they were going to retain people's real names alongside all of their very intimate kind of demographic information. So it actually caused a kind of big resistance movement in a country where I think there's been a lot of trust in government. I would say perhaps ill-placed trust, but there has been a lot of trust in government, and lots of other privacy issues have not really kind of become mainstream problems or kind of penetrated into mainstream discussions. And also kind of interestingly as well, anecdotally, there was quite a bit of resistance from some kind of Australian Indigenous peoples, particularly kind of people associated with movements for kind of the recognition of their sovereignty. So just kind of on the issue of sort of these sorts of censuses and data gathering being a kind of way of governing populations, I think there was definitely some of the resistance there was actually the resistance of this kind of attempt to govern too. But I mean, at the end, the census did kind of occur. It wasn't abandoned, even though there was some speculation that might be the case, given the kind of issues around data, the kind of quality of data being gathered. But I think what may happen in reality is just it will not actually be used by researchers because of large amounts of kind of boycotts and perhaps inaccurate data being given, but that kind of remains to be seen. But it was certainly one of the events which really kind of galvanized sort of public consciousness around privacy issues and around kind of government intrusion in a place where there's not been a lot of that so far.
Okay. Maybe let's connect, let's get one more and then we have a last round of comments, because there was one more hand up there. I don't know if the microphone doesn't really reach. So we had two more comments, and maybe we can, if you have any more thoughts to our panelists, if you have any more thoughts in terms of, what kind of resistance do we need? I was just, while you were talking, I was thinking about, I think it was a talk by Kate Crawford last year at Republica, where I think she said, like, we don't have agency anymore because we're monitored in smart cities and so on, and so what can we do? Do we have agency, and what do we do? Who wants to start? Yes, let's go from there.
Nope. Thank you for those comments. I had a lot of thoughts on both of them, but I'll just stick to this issue of indigenous peoples that you brought up, because another piece of research I've done, which I found very interesting, was about the 2000 U.S. Census, where minority and underrepresented groups were shown through a long set of ethnographic and statistical studies to have very precisely estimable levels of undercount. And the Census Bureau developed a whole set of methodologies to use sampling techniques to essentially make up for the undercount. And this was actually supported by many of the groups representing minorities and indigenous peoples, because in a way they got the biopolitical benefits of being counted, but they weren't personally counted. They were simply estimated on the basis of a smaller sample using a elaborate technique that the Census Department published all kinds of papers on. And I think that's kind of an interesting way to think about disadvantaged and underrepresented groups in this context, is that rather than a full count, which brings all kinds of historical resonances for people like Native Americans, Aboriginals in Australia, who've suffered directly from being registered and counted, sort of provides a side avenue for, in some sense, participating in modern state service provision without having to be personally identified through this indirect method of sampling. So that's just an association I think would be interesting to follow up in other contexts. Thank you.
I was going to mention, in response to Angela's question, one of the weirdest conferences I went to was when the LGBTQ community near Bangalore decided to interrogate the ID system and say, because they'd introduced a category of you could be male, female, or you could be T for transgender, which on one level is really, really enabling and wonderful in a country like India. Talking about like the kind of unintended consequences that Linnet mentioned, people were sort of wondering, saying, until then they had the ability to be ambiguous and not be fixed in a system as being, you know, of one gender or, you know, somewhere in between. And when this fixed them and they had to choose, even if it was T, people had like, and these were uneducated, illiterate people that were bussed in from villages, and people said, well, you're the lawyer in the room, you probably know the answer to all of these questions. I've never heard such weird questions, and they were things the system hasn't grappled with at all. Things like, well, I inherited 3 pieces of land as the oldest son in a Hindu Brahmin family. Now if I go and register as either female or transgender, what happens to my property rights? Do I lose my land? The government has thought of this, yes? And you're like, no, almost certainly no, right? Or people saying, even the act of registering in one of those categories involved a full body search by creepy policemen who didn't believe them. Anyway, they were hermaphrodites. They were people who were, you know, a third gender who is saying, why did I have to be physically assaulted and violated in order to qualify in a particular category to sit inside a neat little box that made sense to someone, which makes no sense to me in my life when I've straddled ambiguity and I've used the benefit of what a friend of mine calls the cycle gap in India, where you hack your way through every system and find the little cracks, you know, in a Leonard Cohen kind of way, that's where the light shines. So it's this cycle gap is, in his view, when you're stuck in a traffic jam in India, it's the exact width that it takes for a cycle to go through the traffic jam. And that's what most people use to navigate their way through systems that exclude them. And if you remove these spaces of grayness and ambiguity and lack of fixation, where do you leave people, especially marginalized people who don't know how to navigate systems, who aren't connected, who don't have access, who are not computer literate? So that's just, you know, in connection with your question, that's something that came up for me.
Okay, David, and then Linnet gets the last word.
I apologize for not answering the last question, but I really recommend the work of Val Steves in the eGirls project in Canada on the growth. And it's been over a number of years. She's done a whole series of longitudinal studies on especially young women and young girls and their engagement with digital technologies over the years. And their reports are fantastic. So I really recommend those. I can give you references later. I wanted to just remind people, if you don't know, that Canada, and I've been involved in this, has just brought back the census, the long-form census, after a campaign by probably the very same people who would have been against it in Germany to restore it. But Matt brought up the distinction here. What we campaigned to bring back was the long-form census, the long sampling aggregated census was designed to support social policies, which the previous Harper administration, the rather authoritarian neoliberal government, had got rid of precisely so it didn't have evidence to say anything about social issues. So it could say there's no social problems, we're going to ignore that, we're not going to gather information on it. The same way they gagged government scientists and stopped them from speaking to the press, which is, by the way, what Trump is doing now in America too. So what was retained was the counting, but what was got rid of was the useful part that allows you to actually target money at particular disadvantaged groups. But the government justified its removal of that census on privacy grounds, even though there were no privacy issues, because that was entirely aggregated. And the Canadian Office of Statistics has a very, very good, world, reputable system for removing any identifying information from that, and they've done it for years. So just to say that the census is not just the census. It's a more complicated sort of instrument, which is, yeah.
You want?
Okay, well, very briefly, I think this has been extraordinarily helpful, at least for me, and I hope it has for everybody else. I think what I'm getting from the panel members is that what's right to do about gathering data on a population changes over time, that it's something flexible. It should be decided in the domain of public reasoning, as Amartya Sen calls it, what solution fits a society at a given time. That may also change, which raises the question of how you future-proof your current data collection methods, which gives the question of how do you work in opt-outs so that people who are worried about that future can change the way they appear in the database 50 years from now. A long-form census has its arguments in Canada, not in Germany, it's going to change, and that has to be okay. So what do we do about the changes? And finally, on the question of young people and social media, that is a really good question to ask. Not enough empirical work has been done on this. I did a study on privacy in Amsterdam Smart City recently, where we interviewed school children about the way that they used the media and where they felt surveilled or not surveilled by the public sector through their use of online platforms. And they have a strategy of resistance where they keep up with the news as to who owns whom, and they switch accordingly. When Facebook bought WhatsApp, they all moved off WhatsApp about 2 years before anybody else did, really. They don't care about convenience, they move as a herd. And they decide what is safe and what is not based on their own parameters. So they may have different parameters, but they're very clear about what they believe and don't believe, and I think that they resist in their own way, and people are not studying it well enough right now. Thank you.
Any final words from our chair? Or we're to conclude the session. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much all for coming, and it's lunch, so... I think everyone's happy to be able to go to lunch.
Okay.
Bye-bye.